in New York City, I was turned into a hologram by the contemporary artist Tony Arisler as part of a project on mesmerism, credulity, fact, and belief. And being a hologram does funny things. It produces a kind of decoupling of the appearance of one's animate body from one's experience of that body. And my holographic projection dramatizes certain questions for me about really how and when perceptual experience acquires evidentiary status. I wonder what authority does bodily experience have in a given historical context to produce or ratify various kinds of knowledge about the natural world. And such questions acquire a real sense of urgency when they're posed about a historical moment in which those very terms are subject to realignment and reconfiguration, and consequently, they've been instrumental in guiding my thinking about a period often described as the end of the Enlightenment. Take this painting, for example. In 1790, the Alsatian-born, London-based artist Philippe de Loutherbourg completed A Philosopher in a Moonlit Churchyard. And in it, a man stands before an empty grave in the ruins of an old church. On the ground, in the form of a stone relief, another man's supine body is sketchily rendered in worn contours of inky brown. Above him, the figure of Christ triumphant is outlined in diluted streaks of umber. His flesh, barely distinguishable from the background, is almost transparent. So our philosopher finds himself betwixt and between two corporeal modalities. Below him lies the opacity and obdurate physicality of matter, and above him, the weightless and vitreous immateriality of spirit. The same year that this painting was completed, an announcement ran in the London newspaper, The World. Loutherbourg, it said, we are happy to hear, has given up the folly of magnetizing for the sense of painting. London audiences were familiar with that reference. Animal magnetism, quote unquote, was one of the most notorious and scandal-ridden medical therapies of 18th century Europe. Although de Loutherbourg, a Royal Academician, is better known today for his evocative portrayal of industrialization in Coalbrook Dale at Night, and also for his luminous theatrical displays. The artist was also famous during his lifetime for his controversial use of animal magnetism or mesmerism. In 1789, Loutherbourg set aside his career as an artist to open a public healing clinic in which he practiced a combination of spiritualism and mesmerism. And his clinic experienced a brief, intense surge of popularity. Tickets to see him were actually sold on the black market. But later that summer, it was ransacked and destroyed by a mob. Now, historians tend to treat his medical practice, to the extent that they treat it at all, and his artistic production as separate endeavors. But the invisible fluid de Loutherbourg claimed to manipulate, and the painterly effects found in many of his large-scale works, share, I believe, unexpected and significant formal and conceptual resonances. They delineate concerns that, in addition to being key to understanding his art, speak to the promises and failings of late 18th century ideas about man's perceptual powers. Now, in taking seriously their cross-contamination or shared concerns, it becomes possible to see his art as an actor in a much broader reconfiguration of observational practices. That's something I can have a larger project on. Although they are not about mesmerism in any straightforward sense, paintings like this one address the powers and limits of human perception, the reliability of experience, and challenges to the very possibility of a fully visible and coherent pictorial field. And in this way, I believe, they describe some of the essential features of a crisis around credibility and empiricism that came to a head in the late 18th century, which the historian of science, Simon Schaffer, has called a crisis of facts. So today, I will touch on just two examples. And I'll begin not with de Loutherbourg, but with a Viennese physician named, of course, Franz Anton Mesmer. Now, in the early 1770s, Mesmer claimed to have discovered a powerful substance he termed animal magnetism. So this was an imperceptible magnet-like fluid that pervades the human body. And this proclaimed that blockages or disequilibria in its flow were the root cause of all illnesses, both physical and mental, which would be cured by restoring its normal distribution within the body. And what you see here on the left is people gathered around one of Mesmer's magnetic tubs, where they receive this invisible fluid, which is flowing through iron rods. Unable to gain professional acceptance in Vienna, can't imagine why, Mesmer moved to Paris, where his magnetic therapies were very popular among France's haute monde. Yet official approval from France's scientific institutions eluded him. The controversy reached a fever pitch in 1784 when King Louis XVI called for formal inquiry into animal magnetism that was led by none other than Benjamin Franklin. Franklin underwent magnetic treatment, he had a whole committee, and the results of this were that they concluded that animal magnetism does not exist. So they publicly debunked mesmerism. But one of the difficulties encountered by Franklin's inquiry, and one of the reasons that many, like de Loutherbourg, continued to practice mesmerism afterwards, vexed numerous empirical inquiries. This is the problem of how to conclusively prove the existence of something that lays beyond man's powers of perception. If Enlightenment conceptions of science, which are used anachronistically, prized knowledge grounded in direct observation, how could one contend with phenomena that could not be directly observed? Direct observation remained throughout the Enlightenment the ultimate tool with which scientists working in the tradition of Lockean empiricism could verify experimental results. Experiments had to be witnessed by a community of experts in order to be admitted to the register of scientific knowledge. Although, as Schaffer and Steve Chapin have argued, this was a process whose actors and activities were carefully regulated according to social, intellectual, and institutional criteria. And Mesmer himself had been eager for members of France's scientific institutions to directly observe his practices. But what kinds of evidence was Mesmer actually offering? And on the right, this is a caricature of Mesmer's treatments as kind of smoke and mirrors. Mesmer's patients consistently claimed to feel within their bodies the effects of animal magnetism, but the actual magnetic fluid evaded human observation. As Franklin's commission of 1784 reported, it, quote, is not luminous and visible, it has neither taste nor smell, its process is silent, and it surrounds or penetrates your frame without your being informed of its presence by the sense of touch, end quote. So put simply, animal magnetism couldn't be seen, heard, smelled, tasted, or touched. Okay, but here was an impasse, right? How could an observation-based empirical science verify or disprove the existence of something that couldn't be seen, something that lay beyond man's perceptual capacities, but likewise beyond the measure of any instrument? Conversely, how else could one account for all of the fainting, convulsing, and shrieking bodies found in Mesmer's clinics? So either it did exist, but revealed a grave shortcoming in man's perceptual acuity, or it did not exist and revealed instead that one could not trust the bodily evidence at hand. De Loutherbourg, like Mesmer, spent much of his life on the margins of credibility. He fled Paris in 1771 under a cloud of scandal and took up work in London not as a landscape painter but as a set designer. His illusionistic receding stage flats and innovative lighting techniques transformed British theatre and introduced a new genre of technology-driven spectacle to London. In 1781, de Loutherbourg revealed an attraction for which he has since become especially well known. I'll show you an illustration on the lower right, the Eidophusikon, which now features prominently in prehistories of the cinema. So spectators would sit in a darkened room in front of a large window-like opening, within which painted scenes would appear to move and change as concealed light sources were manipulated. Now, de Loutherbourg's proximity to the theater proved problematic for his subsequent career as an academic painter. His reputation as a master of stage tricks was incompatible with the model artist described by Sir Joshua Reynolds, whose works were supposed to shine with moral significance, intellectual rigor, and sober pictorial restraint. De Loutherbourg enrolled in a course on mesmerism in the mid-1780s, along with some other artist friends of his. And the heady mix of mysticism, occultism, and alchemy in circulation in late 18th century London meant that mesmerism was part of a pluralistic medical marketplace where borderlines between orthodox and heterodox practices were notoriously blurred. De Loutherbourg soon came into contact with a man who promised to teach him even greater mesmeric powers, who went by the name of Count Cagliostro, who was this famous mystic and grifter, essentially, who counted among his enemies Catherine the Great, Marie Antoinette, Johann von Goethe, and the notorious Lothario Casanova, who he punched in the face, and even the Pope. It seems controversial. De Loutherbourg was immediately drawn to Cagliostro's so-called secret arts, which combined aspects of radical Freemasonry, mesmerism, alchemy, and fortune-telling. The two men became close friends, and they traveled to Switzerland together in the spring of 1787. Cagliostro was trying to avoid some debt collectors. And De Loutherbourg paid Cagliostro a considerable sum of money to be instructed in his mystical practices. After several months, however, Cagliostro was no closer to revealing his secret arts to De Loutherbourg, who eventually returned humiliated to England. Upon his arrival, the London press cruelly mocked De Loutherbourg's gullibility for believing Cagliostro in the first place. So De Loutherbourg, the avowed master of stage tricks, had himself been tricked. Several of the artist's landscape paintings from this moment open onto some of the perceptual ambiguities that lay at the heart of animal magnetism's epistemological precarity. For years, De Loutherbourg's landscapes had been widely critiqued as quote-unquote inventions of fancy that were not based in the direct observation of nature. In the words of one critic, his paintings were the result of, quote, a system not based in truth, end quote. Another review remarked, quote, Monsieur Loutherbourg never condescended to draw from nature, end quote. So in 1788, then, De Loutherbourg was enduring public scrutiny about more than one kind of deception. First, his paintings were not based on direct observation, with many reviews even likening them to stage tricks or magic tricks. Second, he had recently returned from Switzerland, where it was widely reported he had been defrauded by Cagliostro. So De Loutherbourg's own ability to parse what was real, reliable, and credible from mere trickery had faltered in this very humiliating public manner. The Falls of the Rhine was a bid for credibility on both fronts. Set aside were the stage tricks. Instead of the infernal lighting and overly groomed cows that populate much of his oeuvre, this was a landscape that the artist adamantly insisted was based on direct experience. Mainstream reviews took note of the fact that the painting arrived at the summer exhibition conspicuously late, excused on the grounds that it had come directly from Switzerland, and this underscored De Loutherbourg's claims to have based it on the first-hand observation of nature. So in the right foreground, this finely attired couple prepares to visit the falls in a small boat, around which more rustically styled locals gather. But behind this clearly delineated closed forms in the background, or in the foreground, the viewer encounters an intricately varied tonal expanse, lacking both internal and external bounded contours. Modeled shading alludes to deep recesses and bouldered ledges in the topography of the falls, but they are only partially glimpsed through a bleached crush of mist and water. Pictorial distinctions between discrete forms and spatial registers are elusive. And likewise, elemental states, water, mist, and cloud, represented within the falls appear continuous. I don't have time to show you examples of other depictions of waterfalls from this moment, but this is truly unlike them. A similar operation takes place on the level of pigment. Chromatic deposits are thickly encrusted in passages that appear to depict water and become thin and translucent where they evoke a rocky substrate. In other words, pigment is the least materially dense, precisely where it depicts actual material density. So I would venture that the painting replicates for the viewer the artist's own inability to parse what was mere effect from what was true cause. In the years that followed, de Loutherbourg continued to practice animal magnetism, first in public and later in secret, while exploring within his paintings a set of related themes. Perceptual obscurity, unbounded forms, elemental transitions, and matter in its various states. And their most concentrated expression appeared in 1803 when de Loutherbourg completed Avalanche in the Alps, which would become one of his most famous paintings. Beyond an earthen bluff on the left, whose craggy edge divides the composition along a sharp diagonal axis, lies a world in flux. Masses of rock and ice cascade downward and cast off a thick spray of snow that overtakes the landscape and fills the sky. Among the layered whites, greens, and grays at the center of the avalanche, the categorical distinctions between figure and ground, between shape and color, and between light and the surface it falls on seem to have been suspended. De Loutherbourg engaged with the full spectrum of opacity and transparency in his application of oil paint, whose pigmented particles are densely concentrated in some passages where they form an impasto crust, and elsewhere dispersed, diluted into a thin translucency through which you can see primed canvas. So Appalachian Alps is a painting of dissolution. Whatever stabilizing operations had been functional, if perhaps tenuous, in paintings like The Falls, seem to have broken down in the avalanche, which is of course itself a natural event about solid matter falling apart. It's about destabilization. The left midground is populated with figures who, mid-flight, have turned to look at the disaster unfolding behind them. A review printed in The Sun did not approve. Quote, "For, instead of running with all possible speed from such a dreadful danger, they turn as if to gratify curiosity and indulge surprise. Even the dog seems to participate in this kind of philosophical wonder." End quote. You can see the dog. In other words, de Loutherbourg's figures are spectators of their own mortal peril. Two of their companions in the right foreground are less fortunate. I looked at the paintings for days before I even saw them.
Yeah, they're here.
So actually, I might even here and here. Okay. One man, whose backlit form is faintly outlined, has been thrown off of a wooden bridge that has buckled under the avalanche. And the other is only present as a single arm that emerges from a misty cascade of ice and rock just above the bridge. What the spectators in the left foreground actually observe is a world of elemental formlessness in which to which their perceptual powers were unequal. At every turn, de Loutherbourg paints a material world whose borders are permeable and whose structural distinctions are suspended. Even on the level of the application of paint, we find the artist coupling hardened materiality with porous luminosity. So in closing, de Loutherbourg's painted protagonists, physically overpowered and formally penetrated, dramatize the problems that inhere in a body defined by its receptivity to an external force, like animal magnetism, that does not take fixed perceptible form. Again and again, he painted bodies that are operated on by perceptually indeterminate or immaterial forces. Again and again, his protagonists are overpowered, vulnerable, attacked, and acted on. Their bodies are defined in narrative terms by their powerlessness, and were increasingly defined in pictorial terms by their visual obscurity. When de Loutherbourg took up the study of animal magnetism in the 1780s, it had already been widely discredited by Europe's leading scientific authorities. But it remained a concentrated expression of the limitations of and challenges to certain Enlightenment ideas about the authority of direct observation. Mesmerism suggested that, rather than stabilizing the operations of knowledge production, bodies are easily manipulated, controlled, and overpowered, that bodies act without or against the will of the individual, and that bodies are unequal to the task of parsing real truth from mere stage tricks. So what did direct observation give one access to then? What did it mean to be a witness or a spectator, and what kinds of evidence could that perceptual experience proffer? Insofar as de Loutherbourg's viewers were, and perhaps still are, subject to the magnetic operations of his paintings, this is an experience whose evidentiary authority remains very much in doubt.